American women have made great strides in the last few decades, and with 66 million of them in the workforce, they're a major part of America's economy. Women have many opportunities, but challenges remain. Join us as two notable Central Florida women share their experiences as leaders and business people. Next on Metro Center Outlook. Hello, I'm Diane Trees. March is National Women's History Month, so we want to take a little time to examine some issues women face in the 21st century. Our first guest is Brenda Carey. She serves as chairman of the Seminole County Board of Commissioners, as well as CEO and president of her own company. Chairman Carey, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
You have a rare perspective for leadership. You hold a leadership role in a public office. You also hold a leadership role in your private life, in the corporate world. How did you first start and become involved with the political scene?
Well, actually, in the early 1980s, when I went to work for an engineering company called Blunt Sykes & Associates, the goal was for me to get them back into the public sector. They had all worked for Dawkins & Associates, which was, Emory Dawkins was an Orange County commissioner. And when the four of them left to start their own business, he promised them they would never have any public work. And so they started this company in the early 1980s with just a handful of people, and they were doing 100% private work. I was a real estate broker out at Heathrow Development back in the days of Everett Husky and Gino Pellucci, and in the early days of Heathrow. And the two of them started to squabble, and so I started looking around and decided maybe it was time for me to leave. So when I went to work for Blunt Sykes & Associates, their goal was to get into the public sector. And that's really kind of what launched me into being involved with politics, was because I had to figure out how I was going to do that.
So it wasn't any long-standing ambition that you had from early days of childhood or anything. It just sort of evolved into a thing you wanted to do.
Well, you know, I've lived in Seminole County since 1957, so I've been here 58 years, and so it's important to me that we do the right things, but I was involved for 20 years as a volunteer before I ever considered running for office. I really always thought I would like to serve on the county commission, but I really wasn't planning to do it until I retired or a little later in my career.
Now, you're in your private sector. You are CEO and president of the Carey Company. What does this entail, and what kind of business?
I do consulting business. When I first started the Carey Company in 1999, I had four non-competing clients who all pulled from that same group of people that I had built relationships with over the last 20 years. My business model was to have four clients. I had four clients the day I started my business. And when I ran for office in 2004, it actually campaign started in 2002. So I didn't renew two of my contracts so I would have time to campaign. And then when I got elected to office, I chose to just keep one client. And so I manage a real estate portfolio, a commercial real estate portfolio of about 1 million square feet of real estate.
Who influenced your career path or your leadership styles along the way?
You know, I'd probably have to say my mother more than anybody. She always told me that I could do anything I wanted to do. And my mother was born in 1921, so it was a very unusual to have someone from that time who didn't think I was supposed to grow up and be a housewife or a secretary. When I was in school, you know, we could take secretarial training, or you had home ec, and I mean that was the expected goal. I worked part-time most of the time from the time I was 13 or 14, just because I liked being around people and was pretty mature for my age. And so, I'm not really sure, other than my mother, who always was there saying, you know, you can do whatever.
What a marvelous background to come from.
It really is, and you know, I've had many women along the way who have helped my, probably as far as politics goes, obviously.
Mentors?
Mentor, my friend Sandra Glenn, And it goes back to my days at Blunt Sykes.
What would you say are your main strengths? What helped you build those cornerstone traits for success?
Well, I think never really thinking about the fact that I couldn't do something.
Having confidence.
Again, had, a mother that was always very encouraging to do things differently. I mean, every job I ever had from the time that I went to work at Blunt Sykes, my competition as far as my peers were all men. Back in the 80s in the engineering business, all of the business development managers were all engineers or men that worked for the big companies. And so I competed against them there. Commercial real estate back in the 70s, there really weren't many women in that. Most women sold residential real estate. That was what they expected you to do. They didn't expect you to know anything about commercial real estate or development or those type of things. And I really learned a lot during my years at Blunt Sykes as far as, I would do the public presentation. So if it was a roadway project or a utility project, I would hold the public meetings and, make sure that they got noticed and, really introduce the engineers. And so I learned a lot about development business and, what you can and can't do, zoning laws, land use issues, comprehensive land plans. I mean, Seminole County didn't even have zoning until 1971. So everybody was kind of learning there for a while. I've been involved in a lot of great projects that have shaped this community.
It sounds like when you approach something that you really study it and pull out the pieces. It sounds like you're very prepared for whatever you do.
I try to be. I think that one of the things I think that affect women is that if we go into something and we don't know, nobody ever wants to say, I don't know. I'm happy to say, I don't know if I don't know the answer. But I try to do my homework. I read everything. I'm just an avid reader. I mean, we get agendas and 4-inch thick binders. I had one for the Expressway Authority the other day that was 6 inches thick. And, so I serve on 11 committees in addition to being, the county commission chairman.
Do you think that the leadership skills that you hold most valuable, are they compatible with both of the roles in both the political side of things plus your corporate role? Or do you think you need different skill sets for leadership depending on what the situation is?
I think that leaders usually rise to the top, regardless of what they're doing, whether it be a business. I'm very strategic in my thinking. If I'm looking at real estate, I'm very strategic in trying to locate something. If I'm trying to find a site, for a particular business or what have you, I'm very strategic in my, roles that I like to play on the county commission. I like to serve on the committees where I feel like my experience will be best suited.
Looking at the private sector again, with the community, do you think that we do enough to help promote and encourage women to own their own businesses?
Well, I think that we can just encourage women to understand that they need to just strike out and try. I mean, the worst thing that could happen is that you fail and try again. But if you don't try, you're never going to be successful. And if you don't ask, the answer's no. I think that that's kind of been the secret for me for many things, is I've always asked for help. I've never had anybody tell me that they wouldn't help me, whether it was trying to understand how to situate myself to get a project or what I needed to do. And mostly, I mean, I wasn't asking other women. I would ask men who were in leadership positions, and back in the day when I started again in the engineering business, which was really the first heavy male business that I was engaged in. We had commissioners like Lou Treadway and, Tom Dorman and the good old boys. They were still very much in charge. I did business in Polk County, which was the county manager. Its name was Bubba Smith. I mean, it was a very much a man's world, and you just had to ask for help. And men are very helpful.
I think that aura of confidence is an essential part of what makes you successful. Are there any resources, do you know of, in the community where women can help get leadership skills, build leadership skills? Maybe that's something that we should look at.
I think there are some organizations out there. One of the things that I would like to do when I retire, which it won't be too terribly far in the future, but I'll only retire from what I do today. But I would like to start a mentoring program for women who I've been trying to come up with a name for that, you know. Leading ladies is one that pops to mind, but the idea would be that all women that would be involved in the program, regardless of their age, would have to mentor someone. So you could only get mentoring if you were willing to give mentoring. So we senior women would mentor all of the ages, but a 30-something who's being mentored would have to mentor that 20-something-year-old. And so I think that people helping people is really what it's all about, and I think that women just need to ask for help.
Chairman, you lead quite a multifaceted life. How do you balance and juggle the responsibilities?
I think women are just known for segregating their requirements, and that's exactly what I do. When I walk into the county, I'm 100% at the county that day. If I walk into my real estate office, I'm 100% at my real estate business. If I get home, I turn the phone off and I'm 100% at home. And so I think you have to do that. And I think it's very difficult to be successful and focus on what you're doing, because I think that's really, you know, what has made me successful. I do focus on whatever it is I'm doing. I do my homework. I talk about it with other people that are my peers. And I try to make sure I have the best strategy to succeed. And that's worked very well for me. So that's, you know, being focused regardless of which door I happen to be walking in.
And multitasking. Thank you so very much. When we return, we'll explore how women can find the help they need for success in today's job market. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Pam Nabors, CEO and President of Career Source Central Florida, joins us now to talk about some of the services and assistance available to women who are navigating the job market. Pam, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much, Diane.
Career Source Central Florida takes a two-prong approach. What do you do for businesses? What do you do for job seekers?
Well, essentially, we connect the two. So for businesses, we're identifying where they need talent. We can pre-assess individuals for specific needs that a job or an employer might have, and then refer to them the best candidates for that position. So in many respects, especially for small businesses, we can be their human resources department. For job seekers, we're letting them know what businesses need, particularly sectors that are growing in our economy, and how do we build those strengths. So we either are building strengths through training, technical skill development, or we're preparing their package, their brand, and repositioning them in the job market. So it's that connection.
Do businesses come to you, or do you go out and seek?
Both. Both. So businesses come to us. We're part of the statewide public workforce system. So there's a statewide job bank that's been updated. In fact, this year, Monster is taking over, and I'm very excited about that because it raises the bar and the credibility. And so businesses come and list jobs, but they also come and ask, I'm looking to find a candidate in this specific area. So for example, particularly in information technology, welding, manufacturing now, healthcare, they're looking for special skills. And so they come to us. We also, though, have a dedicated business team that goes out and seeks business is input and understanding what their solutions need to be. So rather than selling our services, we're consulting and identifying how we can fill a gap or refer to a partner agency.
Very practical. Now, with the changes in the increasing numbers of women entering the job market, mm-hmm. especially since the recession, are you finding that reflected in your business, the business element, as well as the number of women coming in?
I think I looked at some of the numbers in this last week, and it's interesting. We're kind of regaining the ground that we lost during the recession. You know, in Central Florida, women were making some strides into the technical areas, in particular manufacturing or professional areas like finance, professional business services. During the recession, those numbers went down. You know, dip down below 35%. But now we're regaining that. Just in 2013, for professional services, women are back still under the percentage of men, but back where we were prior to the recession. So I think we're gaining ground in terms of getting women into those professions. I think that we still have work to do. In terms of the job seekers that we see, when I look at the straight demographics, it's still pretty split evenly.
Now, tell me more about the trends that you're seeing for job opportunities for women.
So I think that definitely a lot of employers in the professional and technical services arena are interested in hiring women in those fields. And so they're actively seeking them through the universities, through the colleges, through the career source efforts here in Central Florida, as well as throughout the state. Particularly interested in women in what might be considered non-traditional occupations. So in construction, for example, construction management and drafting, where their businesses are very interested in women candidates. And I think that we, in terms of looking for those candidates, are continuing to try to find them and also promote those career opportunities to women, particularly young women who are in high school or entering college. I know there's a lot of great programs in Central Florida. We work in partnership with UCF, with Valencia College, Seminole State, with some of our private education partners, and they have many STEM outreach programs for women, but we still need to get the word out that there are incredible opportunities for women in these fields.
With the resources that you have, are they available, are they specifically available for women, or are they oriented, as you say, you're almost equal now on men and women coming in. Can you talk a little bit more about those resources?
Sure. So for men or women coming in, there are a number of different resources. So for individuals who are looking to kind of, as I said, repackage themselves, there are some ways to help them identify how to reshape my resume, create a LinkedIn profile, where are the businesses that are in my sector that I need to focus and market towards. For individuals who perhaps are in their first job or are out of the job market because their skill was perhaps no longer needed, we have training resources that we partner with our educational entities around the region to get their skills up to par. So for example, if they need to understand and be able to work in Java and they were in an IT field previously but didn't have that skill, they need to add that to their repertoire, their skill inventory, add it to their resume, their LinkedIn, get some experience hopefully too, so they might also be in an internship as well as an actual more formal training program.
And that has been very, very helpful. Right. With the jobs searches now, so many companies are looking for exclusivity on websites for job mm-hmm. applications. Are you able to help people navigate that method of applying for a job?
We do. We do help them a lot. It is the reality in the 21st century that most businesses will recruit through their website or utilize, for example, the Employ Florida Marketplace, soon to be the Monster job bank that I spoke about. And I think that although sometimes it's taken for granted that that is the way that people apply, people that are actually coming into career centers don't necessarily understand the nuances. And what I find in talking to our staff in the field is that every employer's online job application is different. There are some basics that we train people around, and then we give them an opportunity to practice, or we do it kind of in a mentoring way with them and help them to identify, how do I get into this particular company's database, and how do I get their attention? Because if it's a larger company, they also have a technology way that they're sorting those resumes. Interestingly enough, though, smaller businesses under 100 people on their payroll, still do use some traditional methods. They use the paper application method.
That's my method.
And they also, a lot of times what our business unit can do is help that company tailor that process, because a lot of small businesses who might have been started by someone who is now not only the owner, the CEO, but also the HR director, doesn't really have any training or formal training in writing a job description. And so they say, I get all these candidates, I put a job application or an announcement in the paper, and I don't even know how to weed through those. So CareerSource can really help with that process on the business side. So that's very important.
Are there any unique challenges you think that women in particular face in the job market?
I think that women sometimes sell themselves short, that, you know, sometimes we're taught as women to be gracious and not promote ourselves. We're considered to be aggressive versus assertive about our skills. I think the most important thing is that you have to be your own brand ambassador, and that we have to package, you know, ourselves, women or men, around what our skills are and how we are the most competitive candidate for whatever position we are applying for. And the other big thing is targeting. You know, a lot of people come into our centers and say, I've applied online and in person, and I've gone to job fairs, and I'm getting nowhere. They're not looking at my application. And I say, have you targeted what you're doing? Have you, every time you put a resume out, do you change how you have targeted that resume towards that job?
Customize
or target towards whatever it is that employer's looking for. That can make the biggest difference for a woman seeking particularly a position in some of these professional business or technical fields.
That was interesting that you said about selling yourself short. I would have thought that a lack of confidence might be part of that, but those are two different things, really.
Yes, they really are. I think it is that we, as women, we're relationship builders, and so we like to learn and talk, and we sometimes will listen versus actually have kind of our message about who we are and how we can deliver for that company. And so we coach women in particular to be ready with that messaging. You know, it's a marketing process, and only you can market yourself. No one is going to do that for you. And that's part of, we have a series of workshops called Develop You, and some of that is building that confidence.
Do you see anything particularly unique about the job market for women here in our area?
I think there are incredible opportunities here in our area. I've had opportunities over the last couple of years to be in a lot of different settings and community organizations. And I will say that since I came here in July of 2012, that particularly the presence of women in management and professional positions in those settings has grown. I can see it substantially. I'm thinking about, for example, the United Way hosts a women's luncheon. And over the last 3 years, the luncheon has grown substantially. And it is really impressive the number of professional, articulate, intelligent, and talented women that are in the job market here and are a part of the fabric of our community. I think that companies are seeing that value. I think that across the industries, as we continue to promote the great things that we have here in Central Florida, that women are going to have more opportunities. So, and because we are growing and because our job market is growing, there are many more opportunities here than perhaps in other parts of the country.
Well, you mentioned the focus on STEM education. With the diversification now, with economic, a more balanced kind of growth.
Yes.
Does that broaden opportunities for women?
It absolutely does.
Especially in our area,
I think. It absolutely does. So, for example, in the growth of Medical City down in the south part of our city and county, there are so many more opportunities in the health sciences or life sciences area for women to potentially look at beyond just the traditional nursing occupations, looking at technicians and biology technicians and support to all of the life sciences research that's going to be going on. Also in Osceola, we have the Research Manufacturing Center that is going to need a lot of talent in manufacturing and engineering. And so those opportunities are going nowhere but up. I think even in our traditional areas, in hospitality tourism, in the management aspects and professional services areas, we're seeing a lot more opportunities for women in those areas.
Pam, if you have one piece of advice to give to any woman who wants to enter the job market in today's arena, what would it be?
It would be customize your search, customize your package, your way that you're putting yourself out there in the market, and be persistent. Be persistent, because you've got to do it. You are your own communications department, marketing department, and persistence will prevail.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for having me.
We've been talking about women and pathways to success with Seminole County Chairman Brenda Carey and Pam Nabors, CEO and President of CareerSource Central Florida. Thanks for joining us on Metro Center Outlook. Until next time, I'm Diane Trees.